So in this real-world example of phone numbers and people, for instance, if we didn't have the phone book yet, we could start with every phone number and call every person and ask for their names. You'd go through a brute force phase that may take a couple of months, but once you're done with this, you have this beautiful phone book, or code book, as they call it in cryptography, that allows you to do the second and third and fourth and infinite number of lookups in basically zero time. So that's the basic idea of an attack that then uses very little time. In fact, zero encryption functions are needed after the pre-computation phase, but that invests storage, in this case, the storage to store every possibility to achieve the faster computation. And that's the basic scheme that in this case is not practical, because this amount of storage would equal petabytes. In fact, hundreds of petabytes, and that storage available to no hacker in the world. Google may have this much, but nobody wants to break GSM phone calls for cheap. So we need improvements on this scheme. Luckily, there are many possible choices between this one extreme, the code book, that uses a lot of storage and very little time, and the other extreme, brute force, that uses a lot of time but very little storage. And those we want to discuss next. Some trade-off points are achieved by a technique called time-memory trade-offs, and that works as follows. We again start with a table of many of these keys, and for each of them again apply the encryption function, but not just once, but several times. And of the resulting data set, that of course will be of the same amount of samples, again, we want to have the same coverage, we throw away most everything, the things in the middle, and only keep the first and the last column. Now, this should be an equivalent in coverage to a data set that, in the simpler scheme, took a lot more storage capacity, and here's how. You're looking up a message found in the last column, then clearly it works as before. You find the message, the encrypted message on the air in this last column, and you look up the key through following the chain that led up to this message. So after finding the message in the last column, you go to the matching entry of the first column and compute the encryption function, in this case, twice. That's the key you wanted. However, how do you find now a message that's in the middle that you didn't, in fact, store on the hard disk? For this, you'll have to apply the encryption function first and then find it. This parameter 3 is configurable, of course, and to crack something of the size of the GSM 64-bit key, we would want to choose a parameter more on the magnitude of a million. So this table becomes a million columns wide, of which you only store the first and the last. Now, if this before took petabytes, and now you only have to store a millions of it, you're down to manageable terabytes. And that's exactly where we want to be to launch this attack on normal today's computers. There is a large amount of academic work to solve these practicality problems, two of which I want to look into to solve exactly these two problems now. The first one, called distinguished points. Distinguished points work off this principle. You again start with a large list of keys, and for each of these you start computing encryption functions. Other than before, though, you're not computing a certain number of encryption functions, but rather you're computing until you hit a certain distinguishing criteria. Oftentimes, the number of zero bits at the end of the of your output. Now, each of these computations may terminate very quickly or terminate very late, so they vary in length the chains. The number of zero bits, however, determines the average length. So instead of a square data set, so to say, where you have a stable height and a stable width, you get more zigzag data set where each line is of different lengths, but on average, it will have the same coverage. Now this solves the hard disk bottleneck because you don't have to go through your computation and chain link by chain link look up on the hard disk. You know that nothing that doesn't have the right number of zeros at the end will ever be stored on the hard disk. So you keep computing up to, let's say, on average a million, and only then you have to do one hard disk lookup. So this scheme is clearly superior to the first one in that it requires the same number of encryption functions, it requires the same amount of storage, but it only requires a single hard disk lookup. Right? So really now you are at seconds, terabytes, and for the hard disk, probably milliseconds. Now solving the second bottleneck, the pre-computation expense, that's a little bit more tricky. And there's a technique needed that gives this whole project its name, so-called rainbow tables. Rainbow tables look as follows. You again start with a long list of keys, and you do the encryption function for each of these keys as before. And you go through all the colors of the rainbow, in this case a million different colors with a million different encryption functions, before terminating your chain. Whether or not you will need a high coverage very much depends on your attack scenario, of course. In GSM, for instance, as we saw before, there's a lot of different packets that are attackable. So maybe your coverage for each single one of them can be very low. And in fact, the project where that we computed, the coverage is much smaller than 1%. And that's still enough to crack each transaction with a probability much above 80%. So the rainbow table helped us to some degree, but we actually mixed it with distinguished points to kind of mix the benefits of both.